This is Breaking the 180, the podcast where we're trying to keep track of everything going on in film, TV, the world, media, the digital revolution, because these are fast-paced times that just keep getting even faster. I'm Alistair Manhefo.
And I'm Sebastian Carrasco. And here we are, first day of March, and Denis has graced us.
Denis.
With Dune Part 2.
You've been fighting the Harkonnens for decades.
Luke!
My family's been fighting them for centuries.
Your blood comes from dukes, them great houses. Here, we're equal. What we do for the benefit of all.
I'd very much like to be equal to you.
Maybe I'll show you the way.
Denis Villeneuve, as you know, as everyone knows who's tuning in, because what other movie is being discussed more about right now? Just unleashed.
Kung Fu Panda 4. Skadoosh.
Dune Part 2, releasing 2 years after Dune Part 1. Both movies had the funny distinction of also being delayed because of events out of the filmmaker's control. You may remember Dune Part 1 was delayed by about a year because of COVID. Dune Part 2 was delayed by quite a few months because of the Hollywood strikes that went on last year. So it was originally going to come out in October 2023, got delayed because of the strikes. Now it's here, coming out March 1st, and I think I speak for both of us when I say it's a pretty satisfying epic, a very good example of the modern blockbuster as it should be.
Yeah, I pretty much agree with you on that front. It is much better than Part 1. Part 1 certainly feels like a prologue. This actually feels like Dune. But contrary to what many of you might be seeing on Twitter or big YouTube channels or even prestige newspapers, I don't think it's a masterpiece. I think it's very good. And specifically, I want to highlight something you just said, Alcee, which I think is very important. Denis has proven, him and Nolan, to an extent, what a studio blockbuster should be.
Yes.
Over the last 10 years or so, studios have gotten lazy. Franchises have gotten lazy. We're seeing movies that look like the visual effects aren't finished, where studio interference turns whatever quote-unquote vision there was into a chopped-up scramble of a product. But here we are, where we have a polished film with all the bells and whistles that $100 million will get you, and I think that is commendable. However, I think on our show today, what we are going to do more of is kind of break down some of the very interesting themes in the movie and why I think both of us don't quite think it's the masterpiece many voices are claiming it to be, where some of its pitfalls are, and indeed, to highlight those aspects of a franchise blockbuster that should absolutely be lauded.
Yeah, I think these days it's kind of easy to call things quote-unquote masterpieces because, you know, especially the last few months, it's been pretty bare out there in the box office. A lot of franchises that used to be a sure thing are now wobbling. You know, everybody knows about what just happened with Madam Web. It's kind of funny how there used to be a period in time, right, where anything with the Marvel stamp was guaranteed to rule the box office. And for the last 2 weeks, the number one movie in the country and the world has been the Bob Marley biopic, The One Love, which itself was actually very shaky. I was not too impressed by that movie. So I think once you go through these funny periods of drought, you know, a movie like Dune drops, which has, you know, excellent craft, a fantastic photography, a really nice sense of, you know, like entertaining scope. You know, it's you know, the word epic has been overused and turned into a cliche, but no, this movie actually is epic. But yeah, would I rank it up there with, you know, the Zone of Interest or something? No. Although Denis is, you know, one of the world's top directors, and the first Dune, definitely, like you said, it felt like a prologue. It felt like an incomplete movie because it was, you know, part one. You know, it still won 6 Oscars. It was an because it was an impressive technical feat. Same with this one. These are impressive technical works that merit seeing them on a big screen. And I think what also sets them apart is that, you know, of course, you know, the source material is this novel by Frank Herbert that's a modern sci-fi classic, etc. But, you know, you can still dumb down material when you adapt it into a movie. And Denis, to his credit, doesn't do that. The movie still has thought put into it. It has really interesting visual symbolism,
which is often undercut by some on-the-nose dialogue. But I think we'll get into that a little bit more when we talk about at least Denis as a recent filmmaker and some of the elements, in my opinion, I don't know how much you agree with me, hold his films back a little bit. And one of those reasons is why I don't think this is a masterpiece by any stretch of the imagination. Now, it was quite an experience in the theater. However, films like this, when one of the major talking points is, well, you have to experience it in the theater, my argument is all films should be experienced in the theater. My real test is when it comes to home video, will people still feel the same?
Yes, I would say this one, when I say this one deserves to be seen in theaters, yeah, I mean, you can definitely argue that for every film or most films. For example, I personally love watching documentaries in theaters. I think it's a really fun experience. And
you saw Moon Age Daydream in a theater, right?
Yes, I saw that at the Dolby where we saw Thanksgiving. And that was a stunning experience. That was a lot of fun. So I think any genre deserves to be seen on a big screen. I think when being specific about Dune, and this is not to rile any film purists out there, but, and I said this about the first Dune, it's worth seeing on the big screen in the same way you should watch Lawrence of Arabia on a big screen, or you should watch Dr. Zhivago or 2001 on a big screen, because the images are so tailored for that large canvas experience. And of course, the canvas can enrich any film experience, but these movies in particular are spectacles, right? Like, they're designed as spectacles. And that's why, I mean, we'll go into a little more later, this comment on Villeneuve's, on Denis' shortcomings when it comes to dialogue, and sometimes the drama's overtaken by the images. But yeah, that's why you should definitely see this one on a big screen, because it's a spectacle. It's a very entertaining spectacle, and it's not a dumb spectacle. That's the nice thing about it.
Absolutely. Yeah. Now, I think before we get into the broad strokes of the film, in Do We Recommend, we do not spoil at all, especially for a film that I know a lot of people are looking forward to. But yeah, I think we should talk a little bit about, because we don't want this to be 6 hours long, but a brief history on who Denis is. And the history of Dune adaptations.
Yes. you know, Denis, of course, Denis Villeneuve has been a notable name now in his field. Even before he became a world-renowned name, he had already started gaining attention in Canada in the late 90s, early 00s or aughts or whatever they call the first decade of the century, doing visually interesting but small-scale art house films. As with most directors, he didn't start with these $100 million, $200 million budgets from the get-go. So he makes these very interesting movies. I was actually talking about one to you right now earlier, a Polytechnic, about an actual mass shooting that happened in Canada in the 90s. And it's a very startling black and white movie from the point of view of the victims. And unlike, let's say, most American movies, you see in this one the actual violence. Like, you see what it's like to be in the school cafeteria and someone gets shot in the face right next to you, but in a non-exploitative way. He really makes you feel the sheer terror of being in one of these mass shootings. He made a film called Maelstrom, which is a dark love affair narrated by a gutted fish. Then he finally gains more international prominence in 2011 with a drama titled Incendies, which is set in a fictional Middle Eastern country,
which you may hear us talk about in a little more detail on an upcoming show we have, which we're putting a lot of research into. So yes, Heads up on that.
Oh, yeah. That's going to be a great one. I'm super excited for that one. And it's a great drama. You kind of see, that's a good movie to start to see his current style emerge, like in terms of the kinds of shots he uses more often now, the kind of photography he aims for. Once again, much lower budget than what he does now, but it's a very epic, in terms of the story sense of this woman who, you know, I'll save it more for the upcoming episode, but, you know, it's set in a fictional Middle Eastern country with a conflict inspired by the Lebanese Civil War of the 1980s and the Palestinian refugee crisis there. And then he, you know, starts building up. He does Enemy with Jake Gyllenhaal, which is a very good, funny, mind-twisting thriller.
Based on Saramago.
Yes, Jose Saramago.
Was it a novel or a short story?
A novella. One of his shorter books, one of his little novels. And then he did Prisoners, which we both like.
I really like Prisoners, and I will be referring back to Prisoners for certain elements in a little bit.
That's a really good kind of Kafka-esque missing persons story that's really good. Great pacing. I watched it recently, and it's over 2 hours, but the pacing is spot on. Like, you're really into it all the way till the end.
I'm just going to throw it out there. For me, it's Denis at his best.
And lit by Roger Deakins.
Yes.
Roger Deakins lit that one. Then he really gains popularity in 2015 with another Deakins-lit movie, Sicario, which is, you know, now I guess you could, I don't know if you would call it a modern classic yet, but it's definitely a well-known movie about the drug war on the El Paso-Juarez border. Very popular performance from Benicio del Toro in that movie. You know, just that's where you really see Villeneuve start to play with this use of atmosphere and sound design over the writing, let's say. You remember a couple of lines of the movie, but what you really remember is the shots, those overhead shots of these DEA agents driving by the border wall. What was that? That music score.
Johansson, yeah. Rest in peace.
Yeah.
The famous, you know, sunset shot with the border patrol walking by with Emily Blunt. The famous shootout at the border.
Yeah. Written by this guy who's now the king of TV in a way, the Yellowstone creator,
Taylor Sheridan.
Yes, he wrote that script. which that really, I mean, he had done Hell or High Water before that, but
excellent film,
great film, yeah. Now, but Sicario is really the one that turns him into a big game writer and now showrunner. You know, he's got like all these Yellowstone spinoffs and all that happening. Then Villeneuve. Now here's where we see Villeneuve transition into what probably got him the Dune gig, which is science fiction. He does an acclaimed film, Arrival, in 2016, about human contact with extraterrestrial visitors and what it would take to decipher forms of communication between us and an alien life form.
Based on an acclaimed short story by Ted Chiang.
Yes, yes. And then, you know, he really goes big with the Blade Runner 2049, the sequel to Ridley Scott's sci-fi classic.
Reunites with Deakins. Deakins gets his Oscar.
Yes.
For that film.
Gorgeous movie. Oh my God, that's one of the best looking sci-fi movies of the
like ever, of ever, really. Yeah.
And
then we get to Dune.
Now we get to Dune. So he gets the gig to adapt Frank Herbert's Dune. Those of you who are into sci-fi and sci-fi literature, you know, you already know what we're talking about when we say, you know, this book for years was like a holy grail for adaptations. It's the backstory of how this became a movie is worthy of multiple documentaries in itself. And in fact, there's a great, great documentary called Jodorowsky's Dune from 2013, which chronicles how in the late 70s, Alejandro Jodorowsky, a Chilean surrealist who became very well known in the 70s for two really big cult films that are like trippy, hallucinatory experiences, El Topo and The Holy Mountain, he gets the gig to do Dune. And I won't spoil too much because you really got to see this documentary and discover it on your own. But it becomes...
It's almost, if we even mentioned the scale of what he wanted for this project, you would call us liars.
Yeah, it's kind of nuts. I mean, to give you a sense, Pink Floyd was going to do the soundtrack. Orson Welles was going to play the Harkonnen, the Baron Harkonnen. Salvador Dali was going to be the emperor. I mean, it was a crazy, wild thing. Now, the funny, after the budget got so crazy, so big, and Jodorowsky's, he's too much of a kind of a wild-eyed mystic to really work in the Hollywood system. But the project ends up getting shelved because it's just too big and the budget is too out of control and the screenplay is almost like, you know, it's denser than the Bible. Some of the people Jodorowsky hires to design the movie go on to get bigger Hollywood gigs. Geiger, who was the production designer, ends up designing Alien for Ridley Scott. So it's a great documentary. Check it out. Finally, the first real big movie gets made in 1984, and that's David Lynch. David Lynch, who had just gotten some prominence for Elephant Man, which had gotten him Academy Award nominations, decides, you know, I'm going to try my hand at blockbuster filmmaking. So he does his own Dune, which ironically enough is more of a complete movie than these two Denis films, because he actually tries to tell you like one whole complete rounded thing in a long movie. Also, it's like 2 hours, 2.5 hours long.
However,
I mean, the movie it's a mess. It's the acting's kind of funny. The screenplay's all over the place. It was a big flop at the time. In fact, thankfully it was a flop, because after this Dune crashes, Lynch decides to go back to his true self and does Blue Velvet, you know, which is one of the great movies of the 80s. But it's still an interesting movie to watch. It's got some quirky performances. It's got Sting playing someone we'll be talking about later in from this Dune.
It's one of those, I don't know if we could call it a bad film, but it's such a curious object of fascination.
Yeah, you know, you can see Lynch's eye because he's obviously very talented. But, you know, I think what you're seeing with Dune, and Matt Zoller Zeiss wrote about this recently in a essay he wrote looking back at Dune Part 1, that the problem with the 1984 Dune is that it's a mismatch between the material and the director. You've got a great director doing material he doesn't really care about. Like, you can tell this is just not Lynch's thing. And he famously, if you look it up on YouTube, there's an interview where he famously talks about being offered Return of the Jedi and not being able to bring himself to do it.
And there was George. And he talked with me for a little bit, and then he said, I want to show you something. Now, right about in this time, I started getting a little bit of a headache. He took me upstairs, and he showed me these things called Wookiees. And now this headache is getting stronger. And he showed me many animals and different things. Then he took me for a ride in his Ferrari for a lunch. Then I got a really, almost like a migraine headache. And I could hardly wait to get to home. Kind of crawled into a phone booth and phoned my agent. I said, there's no way, no way I can do this.
Now, I believe there was also some sort of miniseries.
There was a 2000 miniseries, also Dune. Well, yes, of course, titled it, because it's an adaptation, which actually I have not seen, I confess, but it was kind of tricky to find. I don't think you can stream it that easily. I don't think it's easy to find for streaming, and I don't know if it ever made it to Blu-ray or anything. I think it's just like on DVD, but it was part of this trend in the early 2000s where cable and network TV were trying to aim a little higher with their miniseries. And so they were, trying to adapt classics again.
It kind of set the foundations for what we see now with HBO and Netflix getting incredibly ambitious and bold with their adaptations and IPs.
I mean, that was like a golden period for that kind of thing. You got like The Odyssey with Armand Asante, Merlin with Sam Neill. And
amazing soundtrack for that.
Astounding soundtrack. And then, Dune was part of that. It got critical love. But, and I think people liked it. They just didn't love it. And for years, that kind of just remained the last Dune anybody would get. And of course, if you follow the books, there's Dune Messiah. Frank Herbert passes away and his estate just keeps. I think they're still churning out Dune books. There's still like a bunch of spinoff books. I was at the library yesterday and I happened to walk by the H's, the Herbert, where Herbert would be listed, right? There's a bunch of Dune books that are spinoffs from the first Dune. And so now that we live in this era of remakes, sequels, reboots, revivals, legacy sequels, spin-offs, whatever, Denis got tapped with bringing Dune back. It makes sense, going by the movies we just mentioned. Dune Part 1 comes out in 2021. It gets a lot of acclaim. Box office hit.
There was a big sigh of relief from people. Like,
yes.
Okay, he gets it.
Yes, he got it. Yeah, he got it and gave it the proper space. I think another problem with the Lynch movie is, and this was common back then, right? You didn't have this idea of movies essentially chopped in half. And that really doesn't even become a thing until the Matrix sequels in 2003 and then Kill Bill. Those movies kind of solidify this idea that, you don't necessarily have to make sequels, but you can chop a movie in two, basically. And that's how these Dunes feel. And so Denis gives it the proper space and scope to let the story play out, to focus on the, well, the nods at Middle Eastern culture, that whole mystical element in the Herbert story.
And we're going to get into that a lot more in part two.
Yes, absolutely. Part one is more of a setup. You're basically being introduced to this world of the House of Atreides versus the Baron Harkonnen and his people, and they all live under the shadow of the Emperor, and basically they all want control of this planet Arrakis because it produces spice, which is like their version of oil or every other natural resource.
It does like everything, right? It's fuel for interstellar travel. I think it can also be a drug. It does everything. It's the magic. It's the magic pixie dust, you know?
Yeah, it's like it's almost like a metaphor for just natural resources in general, and how societies fight over them and are willing to go to war over them, and imperialism, right, becomes obsessed with controlling resources. And so part one, if you may remember, ended up on a cliffhanger where the Harkonnen's men, his army, wipes out the House of Atreides, killing, you know, Oscar Isaac, Timothy Chalamet's dad in the story. And
I will say I wasn't a super huge fan. I appreciated, you know, the technical elements, that it was taking the material seriously and all that. But I will say the scene with Oscar Isaac and the Baron Harkonnen at the dining table was fantastic.
That
might have been the best scene in the movie, in my opinion.
Well, especially when you compare it to the Lynch one where you kind of chuckle. There's so many moments in the Lynch movie where you chuckle, and then you watch it in the Denis film, you're like, oh, okay, I see what this was supposed to be. For example, the way the Baron Harkonnen floats, the way he levitates, in the Lynch movie is just kind of funny. But in the Denis version, it's menacing, you know?
My desert. My Arrakis. My Dune.
Of course, because it's also Stellan Skarsgård, you know, who's a fantastic actor. I mean, he's just one of the... Well, that whole fucking family is blessed with amazing acting DNA. As we've been finding out over the last few years, there's a Skarsgård in everything now. And he's very good in part two. So part two basically picks up right where part one left off, where Paul Atreides, played by Timothy Chalamet, is now wandering the deserts of Arrakis with the Freemen, who are essentially the natives of Arrakis. And he's adapting into their ways. He's with his mother also.
Bene Gesserit.
Exactly. And so who is becoming more of an oracle kind of figure among the Freemen, because the Freemen, in particular the leader of the Freemen played by Javier Bardem.
He's so great in this movie.
Oh, fantastic.
They finally really gave him a great role in a blockbuster. He hasn't had one.
Yeah, that's
I don't
true.
Know since well, what, forever.
Well, what other blockbusters has he been in?
Pirates of the Caribbean.
Oh, that's right. You know those.
Little Mermaid.
I didn't see that one, but Pirates. I don't even remember what he did in that one. But yeah, so his character in this one is convinced in this idea that Paul is the Mahdi, you know, this kind of messianic figure foretold by prophecy, who's supposed to lead Arrakis towards
paradise. And yes. I think that's what we'll leave the plot, seeing as this film is fresh at time of recording. So I think now let's start with the good elements first. I think let's kind of break down some of the very interesting themes, parallels to real world, before we start getting into the real question of why we didn't find this to be the masterpiece that many people consider. And you've already started touching upon one of those, which is the Freemen.
Yeah.
A lot more in this film than in part one, for obvious reasons. The parallels to resistance groups in the Middle East should not fall on blind eyes. And if you do miss that, to be honest with you, I'm not sure if we live in the same plane of reality.
Well, it's very interesting. When Herbert wrote the book, right, it's very interesting because you wonder how conscious Denis is of the symbolism in the movie, which, of course, doesn't take away from what he's doing. I mean, sometimes you achieve striking things making art unconsciously. When Dune first came out in 1965, the world in 1965 is a hotbed of anti-colonial struggles. The Vietnam War is really heating up. It's around this time that the Palestinian movement at the time represented by the PLO is really gaining prominence. And funny enough, there was also this fascination by the counterculture with Middle Eastern mysticism. So a lot of hippies would travel to countries like Iran and Lebanon and Iraq to try to tap into that idea of the East as being this mysterious, mystical place. Even as it's a hotbed of political upheaval, when, of course, we don't need to tell you that the Middle East is today probably the most revolutionary corner of the planet, literally.
And particularly in this film, it's not just about the insurgency. One thing Denis gets across very well through the character of Paul and the machinations of the houses is the idea of co-opting resistance, how you can get indigenous populations, particularly those with fundamentalist views, to basically back a white guy, an outsider, but even more nefarious than that, as we see throughout this movie, again, we're not spoiling anything, all these conflicts in the world of Dune are basically manufactured.
Oh, sure. Well, the Harkonnen, right, are essentially planning a genocide to take over the spice. The Emperor is kind of playing the House of Atreides. He's playing these people like chess pieces, right? The House of Atreides versus the Harkonnen. He doesn't really care as long as somebody keeps providing him with spice.
And, of course, he has his kind of cabinet, these Bene Gesserit, these, I don't even know what you would call them, shamans.
Yeah, they're kind of
wise women,
kind of mystics, basically. I mean, it's I've always wondered about that story element. I'm like, what do they really do aside from what, like mind control? I don't know what else they do aside from just do the Jedi thing. They kind of just do the Jedi mind trick thing, basically. But that's probably why he doesn't use them too much in part two.
They help plant the seeds for events that they will control.
Now,
basically.
The white savior element, I think there the issue has more to do with the fact that Herbert wrote the novel as a very typical sci-fi, it's a sci-fi thing, and of course with dashes of orientalism, I don't think we can escape that,
Sure, but I think in this film, what Denis does, I don't know if it was an intentional thing, but the way it plays out in the film, it doesn't look to Paul as the good guy, as the savior. In fact, it almost views him or views the situation with a critical lens to show us how hypocritical these things are and how easy it is for all intents and purposes to lose the plot of a revolution, of an uprising.
I think he's almost criticizing the idea of blind fanaticism, right? So the Javier Bardem character is so devoted to the idea of the Mahdi that anything Paul does, he'll kind of find an excuse for it, right? Even when there's a something like a, even when there's a mistake, you know, he'll still convince the free men that, like, oh well, you know, the Mahdi is so humble that he that of course he would deny that he is the Mahdi, you know. However, I think Denis just can't, I don't think he wanted to change the structure of the, or the idea of the book, because it's such a popular book. And what I mean is, he basically had to keep the guy looking like Timothée Chalamet, because that's what happens in the book. But I think he is trying to play around more with this idea of messianic figures and how they're not incorruptible, right? And I won't spoil, but by the end of the movie, yeah, you're not totally convinced Paul won't become power hungry and tyrannical. However, I still think there is, I still think the story is doing like a Matrix Neo thing, right? Where he is like the Superman in training. You know, I think that's still kind of the idea, except Denis makes him flawed. He's not like Keanu Reeves in The Matrix, who is, you know, just a straight-arrowed, you know, flawless guy, and the only mistake he might make is going a little overboard, you know, in fighting the agents or something, you know. So, yeah, I agree with you there. I think there's a lot of critique of this idea of a messiah figure. The fact that he's white, though, I kind of just think that at Warner Brothers, they got together and they were like, hey, man, well, I mean, can we change up the way the guy wrote? No, man, I mean, there's too many fans.
I mean, too many people. He's an outsider, right? Yeah. He comes from this the House Atreides. So yeah. It makes sense in the story. I don't think that is inherently the problem.
Yeah.
I like the fact that in this adaptation, it tries to do something different, or it actually shows you how these messianic figures come into place and how they're manufactured. Because, yes, honestly, we don't really see that. I'm glad you brought up The Matrix. In The Matrix, in the first one, which is, wow, what an incredible film.
Yeah.
The other two have problems, but I still think they're quite good films.
Yeah, no.
Neo proves himself once, and then he can do anything in there.
Yes, yes, yes.
But in Dune Part 2, one of the strengths, yeah, you see that process happening. You see how the different sides manipulate the scenario for him to become this guy, particularly with his mother. Boy, yeah. Does Rebecca Ferguson kill it in this movie.
Oh yeah, she really swings between being a little menacing to being very vulnerable, and you really, well, yeah, from her you also get the sense of, see, what I like about the movie is it does plant seeds of doubt in her and everyone, especially the Zendaya character. They're kind of like, well, is he really that, or are we kind of just manipulating the situation to make sure the free men follow us into battle, you know? Is it worth turning all these people into fanatics just to take on the Baron Harkonnen? So she's very good in that. I didn't feel throughout the movie that she was always convinced Paul was the Messiah, basically, you know. I did.
Oh, interesting. Yeah. I read it completely differently. I think she wanted it to happen and essentially wills it to happen based on her desire for it to be so.
Yeah, but I mean, there's this, because I liked how they show how they're clearly proselytizing, right, to the freemen. And, yeah, no, I think you get a sense from her that there is still a kernel of doubt. And I like that, too, in the Zendaya character. Zendaya does a little more in this movie.
I'm glad you brought her up.
Yeah.
After Part 1 and Part 2, she's not the right actor for that part. I could not buy what she was selling.
I think they tried too hard with Zendaya in this movie in selling her as the, and this is not a slight on what they're trying to do, but.
Well, I like what the character of Chani is way more in this movie, especially in the third act. We're going to talk about that all in vague terms, because not only is it the best part of the movie, but the most spoilers, it's just who they cast
Well, they tried too hard. I think they tried too hard to keep her as a one-note, the strong female character. But by keeping her in one note, basically, which is this, you know, it's like she's the entire time she's in tough mode, right? Like, there's never a moment where we really get to see the character of Shani become anything other than just the tough ass.
Well, love interest.
Yes. And because Zendaya is an excellent actor. I mean, she's fantastic in Euphoria, which is, of course, the show that's made her name. In that show, she shows off a lot of vulnerability, a lot of range. And even in Spider-Man, you know, in Spider-Man, I think she's very good in that role. This one, yeah, I'll even say the same thing for Chalamet. I think sometimes Chalamet, I think it's a case where the size of the movie is what really makes it work, because if you were to strip down all of the production design and essentially the whole craft of the movie, I don't know if Timothy would be able to carry this thing all by himself either. You know, he's a very...
I agree with you 100%. Yeah. Now, he proves himself a little more in the last third of the movie.
Yeah.
But, yeah, even in part one, I got what they were trying to do with the character, and I like that. But again, not the actor for that part for most of both of those movies. Now, that brings in one of my negatives. And I don't know at what level this comes down. I don't know if it's just how Denis directs. I have a hard time getting emotionally invested in the characters of his more recent films. I'd say particularly starting with Sicario. He's a very big picture guy, and he does that well. A lot of people don't even do that well. But Emily Blunt's character in Sicario, I didn't really care about her. Amy Adams and Jeremy Renner, I understood what he was going for, but there seems to be a disconnect with the idea Denis wants to get across and how he's telling his actors to convey that.
Well, I think
edit that together.
I just think he's too in love with the images. That's actually an issue I had with Blade Runner 2049. I thought that was a beautiful film to look at and to immerse yourself in, but I didn't really care about the characters. I was not very much, I wasn't engaged by them. I didn't really care. Arrival, I really liked the idea way more than the characters. Sicario, the only one I really cared for was the Benicio del Toro, because he's the one with gravitas, and he's the one with a more fascinating backstory. You get more about why he's there, and you want to know where he's going. Whereas Emily Blunt is just kind of a convenient figurehead. Not a figurehead, but a convenient character. Like, oh, she's the kind of less experienced cop in this world, and yeah. But
he does a better job with his side characters.
Yes.
I mean, even Sicario, the Josh Brolin character.
Oh, way more fascinating. Yeah, way more fascinating.
Same with Blade Runner, Joy, and the Mackenzie Davis Lady of the Night,
yes,
so to speak.
Yes.
In Arrival, I mean, Forrest Whitaker is very good in the film.
Yeah, no.
All these other elements, but when it comes to the main characters, and now this is where I go back to Prisoners. The reason I love Prisoners, he gets that perfect. Hugh Jackman is great. And I actually feel incredibly emotionally invested in what the characters are going through, both story-wise and performance-wise. I'll go to the scene with the hammer when Jackman has, I'm not going to spoil that film either, a certain character against the wall, and he has this hammer and is going at him. I am locked in, both because of what's happening in the story, but what that means for Jackman's character.
Yeah.
And a lot of that is missing in these bigger films of his.
I think because the stakes are different, right? In Prisoners, you know, again, not to spoil too much, but in Prisoners, basically Hugh Jackman kidnaps a guy who he's convinced knows where his child has been taken because his child is missing. So you're watching the scene thinking, wow, I hope he's not wrong. Because if he's wrong, wow, you know, he's really crossing a line that he's not going to be able to go back to. And you don't get those kinds of stakes in some of the other movies, right? In Sicario, again, you only really care about Benicio del Toro because he's this lawyer whose family was killed by the cartels. And so you wonder, is he going to get revenge? Is he going to redeem himself? What is going on here? But then Arrival and Blade Runner, you're just kind of taken in by the concept. You know, like Arrival, that's a fascinating movie about, yeah, okay, fine. If aliens were to land, how the heck would we find a way to communicate with them? And Blade Runner 2049, I frankly don't even remember the plot. I don't even remember what the guy's goals
He's
are in the movie.
He's kind of a cold director in that sense, even in Dune Part 2. Look, the images, both practical cinematography-wise, Greg Fraser's back at it, the flawless visual effects, and very rarely do I say flawless.
Yeah.
The big spectacle set pieces.
Oh, but in this one, they're definitely flawless.
I mean, 100% flawless, and that's not even a joke. But it's still a cold style of filmmaking, and that includes the pacing. That first two-thirds of the movie, look, I love patient films, but it has to have intensity. And I think part of that is, one, I do think a little sanding at the edges, but also what we were talking about, the concept and framework is there. And I think Denis and his editing team are editing the movie based around the fact that they already presume that the emotions that are written in the script are just being acted the way that they're supposed to. And I don't think they are.
Yeah, I think what's going on with him is, again, he kind of personifies this new kind of blockbuster director that's emerged almost, I would say, in like a post-Spielberg landscape. And what I mean by that is blockbusters used to be defined by these guys like Spielberg, right? Or even James Cameron, who in a way wear their hearts on their sleeve, right? I mean, these guys are...
Avatar, Way of Water.
Avatar, Way of Water, yeah. Jurassic Park, you know. These are movies that... Star Wars, right? George Lucas. These are movies that are huge, but, you know, for all the flack the Star Wars prequels got, they wear their heart on their sleeve, right? I mean, they're unabashedly romantic, and there's despair and stuff. And,
despite the execution.
Yeah.
And I think Denis has the opposite problem. The execution is great, but then he's not, he almost feels afraid to actually put himself and his own feelings into the picture.
Well, I think he forms a trend with these guys like Nolan also, right? You know, and I really liked Oppenheimer, precisely because it's got a little more personality to it. But Nolan and Denis and this whole crop, I would also count Ari Aster in there in that group. Not so much with his new one. I thought Ari Aster's new one at least was much more personal. But when they make these big movies trying to really grab attention, they really are more about the execution than putting something personal of yourself in it. So, for example, Spielberg's Indiana Jones movies. When you watch them, even the lesser ones, well, I guess there's only one lesser one. Kingdom of the Crystal Skull is kind of like the weakest one in the Spielberg batch. I'm not even going to mention the one that came out last year, but which wasn't even directed by him. But Spielberg's Indiana Jones movies, yeah, they're big, they're silly, they're fun, but you still feel him putting personal things in the movie.
You know what? Crystal Skull is perfect.
Yeah.
You watch that and you're like, yep, this is 100% a Spielberg film. All the things, the character quips, the pacing, he's leading that ship.
Well, the daddy issues.
It's all there.
The daddy issues that define Spielberg, and I mean that in a positive way, especially if you've seen The Fabelmans. They're still there, you know. Indiana Jones and the Crystal Skull, yeah, you know, they're looking for aliens and Mayan temples and all these things. But at heart, it's also about Indiana Jones having to reckon with his son showing up again in his life, right? And Dune Part 2, in a sense, yeah, it does deal with big themes, right? This idea of rebellion against occupation, genocide, and
co-option of rebellion, how imperialism actually works in the way people think in that manner.
The power of belief. But I don't know how much of Denis is personally invested in these topics. And that's also, funny enough, that's what you get from the Lynch movie. You watch the Lynch movie and you're kind of aware Lynch himself isn't into this. I think Denis is into his Dune movies, but almost like he's just having fun making them. Like, he really enjoys putting them together. But
that top-down perspective.
Yeah, but I wouldn't know how to pinpoint something about him in the movie, right? Which in his earlier movies, you got more of a sense of the things that concern him, the things that obsess him.
Well, in Prisoners, which it's a pretty slick American-produced film, I feel that in the film. Actually, it makes me want to go watch it again. But yeah, these last big, I mean, we're talking about the big boy studio movies. I just don't feel that. And it's a little tragic. And it also comes down to, the pacing. I think it's not necessarily just an editing thing. It's the fact that the passion of the captain of this whole ship isn't weaving his personality into the fabric, like I said earlier. And then you get to the amazing spectacle, you know, the arena fight with Austin Butler and these just incredible sets, incredible moments.
Which I really liked. I'll quickly add, I love that scene. It takes place in the Harkonnen world.
Shot in infrared.
And there's a black sun, because there's a black sun that's what they have there, you know, because they're in a other corner of the cosmos. And but it looks fantastic. It almost looks like something Fincher would have directed. And what I like about that scene is it shows how, if you just look at Denis' work aesthetically, when he does these sci-fi things, he does know how to genuinely conjure that feeling that you're in an alien world. So I love that about the Harkonnen.
Well, remember when
arena
Thor,
scene?
Yeah. Love and Thunder, tried to do the black and white thing and you're just like, whatever? No, he does that successfully. Yeah. And Austin Butler is...
I love that. This spoils nothing of what happens, but I love that scene in the arena scene where those other figures come out in those old black costumes.
In the gimp suits.
Yeah, and you're just like, this really feels like some kind of other... What it would feel like if you were dropped in another planet with a completely different everything.
Ruled by these sociopaths. And Austin Butler is as Fade, is great, famously played by Sting in the in the Lynch version.
Wait, yeah. I don't know. I mean, Sting, hey, he at least went for it.
But
I'll give him credit for that.
You know, he's great.
Yeah.
His screen time isn't overdone. Let's just say he also has an affinity for blades and a flamethrower.
Yeah, but in a good way. He oozes this really great, you know, just menace. He's like he's in the IDF, right? He just likes to kill.
Well, that's like Batista.
Yeah.
I mean, when they rain all the missiles down on the cave, and the moment that the free men come up to attack them, they scurry away like the chickens they are.
Yeah, like exactly. Yeah. Oh well, but Batista does a little more in this one too.
But he's that's because good. He's a side character.
Yeah. Oh, but you know. But I'll also give it to the fact that we really were watching half a movie the first time. So in the first movie, it's like Batista, he's just kind of the enforcer, right? Who's kind of sent, he's just basically following the Baron around, right? And nodding his head. In this one, the Baron has put him in charge of Arrakis, and he has no idea what to do about this insurgency that's going on. And so we see a little more of him not being able to handle being the overlord of this planet, and so he starts flipping out and losing his mind because he doesn't know how to deal with the Freemen. So he's like an alien Netanyahu, you know. If anyone gets offended politically,
well, that's the Baron.
Care. Yeah, that's exactly. No, but I mean, I can imagine these guys in private. Why can't?
Oh, 100%. I mean, look, what happened in. Or what's been happening in Gaza? I don't know if Denis or someone in the production was making that overt reference. But
no, I mean the post production on this was probably going on. You know, they probably finished post production way before.
But
the
it's
war
hard
broke out.
Not
yeah.
to see those parallels, and of course that's any occupying force. And those are the things I liked when he showed us that. You know, he gets these big themes and does a good job of actually weaving them into the movie. However, and you mentioned dialogue at the very beginning of the discussion, we'll see all that, and then he'll undercut it with someone explaining exactly what just happened. It's like, no, come on!
But you know, but that is a typical problem. You know, it's actually really hard to write a blockbuster well. You know, so many blockbusters are just really not that. Yeah, I'll give you an example. Avatar 1, right? Excellent blockbuster, excellent action movie. I don't know. Cameron's dialogue, though, gets a bit. I would argue his best script is Terminator 2. I'll be honest. I don't know. I'm sure some people will probably say Titanic. I'll say True Lies and Terminator 2, I would say, are his best screenplays.
That.
You know, but most of the time, his big blockbuster movies have the same problem. Even though they have way more heart than Denis, they still have the same problem, like The Abyss. If you watch The Abyss, they explain everything. All that. So, you know, it's like whenever they're filling up Ed Harris's helmet with that embryonic fluid, we're watching it happen, but... So remember, this is embryonic fluid that is at this and this temperature, and you just have to breathe it, just like an infant does. And the woman, you're like, well, but you said that at the beginning. At the beginning of the movie, you already explained what it is. And yeah, I think Denis with this one, it's almost like it's an insecurity that you're putting so much on the screen, people will forget what the hell you're talking about. So it's like he's trying to like, yeah, he's explaining everything. And yeah, a lot of the dialogue is way too on the nose in this movie. And we've talked about this before.
Well,
you're
saying way too on the nose. I'm saying it could not be more on the nose explaining the themes or what the character is about or what their intentions are.
Yeah.
And it's just frustrating. It's just frustrating because then you get to the third act, which is by far the best part of the film. And you know why? Because there's mostly no dialogue. It's pretty much all action.
No, exactly. It's
I mean that knife fight between Paul and Fade, which is not spoiling anything because they show clips of it in the trailer.
Oh, it's fantastic, but I don't I I think I know where you're going with this. But what I liked about it was one of those nice moments where they genuinely shut up. You know, it's not like while they're fighting, Austin Butler is like, did you know that the House Harkonnen or something?
Or,
so it's like,
or
no,
they don't
just
have
fight.
A side character, like an extra in the background, explain to the camera what's going on, which we've seen in plenty of other films before.
Yeah, exactly.
Even the assault on Arrakis, which, man, that did give me goosebumps. Also, Hans Zimmer's intern score for this movie. Kind of epic. I've been listening to it.
I would argue superior to the first one.
I agree on every level. That guitarist shreds so hard in that. Deep guitars, deep electronics. A lot more creative with how
Middle Eastern sounds.
Yeah. And the way that he plays with the main themes of the film and how those themes are twisted and progress. The way the story progresses and where the characters are at, genuinely very good. And yeah, the assault on, well, the third act assault, I mean, that is classic movie magic and spectacle.
No, exactly. It's one of those films that, again, it kind of gives you something that's been missing a lot in contemporary filmmaking, which is this love of genuine awe in movies. And what I mean by that is, even, you know, if you look at these recent Marvel films like the Marvels and stuff like Aquaman, they're throwing a lot of stuff at you on the screen, but they lack a sense of awe. You know, like they lack a sense of really telling a story that's epic.
They're there for the sake of, we can do it on a computer. And yeah, lots of stuff was done on the computer, of course. I mean, it's a big movie set on an alien planet. But the way that it's handled with climax and actual three-act story structure of a gigantic battle, it's great. And yeah, it leaves you with awe, not just because, oh, the action is cool, but how the disparate elements come together.
And the story's actually engaging. I mean, for all the stuff we're kind of slamming Denis for, the story itself is at least genuinely engaging. You really want to see, well, okay, is this guy the Messiah? What the hell's going to happen with the Harkonnen?
What's going to happen with the Emperor, played by Christopher Walken, all people?
Yeah, I mean, what's going to happen? Hell, you're genuinely intrigued by Florence Pugh as the Emperor's daughter, you know, who's a new character that comes in. And, you know, I mean, even the Zendaya stuff, even if her performance isn't the best, the movie at least ends on a nice suspenseful note with that character. And I'll use that to segue into how we keep talking about how this is part two of part one. This one still ends on basically on a to be continued note.
It does. However, it's a more complete to be continued.
Yes.
Part one was straight up like a TV edit.
Yeah,
where it just fades to black and it's like where's the rest of my movie? This one, the story on Arrakis, or at least Paul's story on Arrakis, because I have no idea about Dune Messiah, the plot beats in that story is complete. So, but I understand where you might be a little frustrated, where it's like, but he did that already in part one. And you know, a frame of reference I'd like to use? The Lord of the Rings.
Oh, no, yes.
That, one, genuine spectacle masterpieces. I'm using that word, each individual movie and all three together. But if you watch the movies, each movie tells a complete story. You can watch Two Towers, and it has an arc for all the characters, for the larger scale of Middle Earth, and it's complete. But then when you watch all three back to back, yeah, it tells a beautifully flowing story of the Ring Bearer.
And well, and of course, it's a great comparison because both are based on these classic genre novels, you know, these books that already had huge devoted followings before the movies were made. So yeah, that's an excellent comparison. And yeah, maybe Jackson was the last of those genuine, wear your heart on your sleeve, epic directors, right? Because it's shortly after Lord of the Rings, Return of the King premieres that the kind of new age of franchises begins with, you know, Batman Begins, soon after that Iron Man. The superhero reign really comes in right after Lord of the Rings. And some of those do have a lot of heart. Guardians of the Galaxy, right, I think is a perfect example.
The first Iron Man.
The first
legitimately
Iron Man.
Great movie.
Now, though, I think epics, well, movies large and small, with the exception of some indies, are really reflecting more the hyper-digital culture we live in.
You know what? Jackson, he's both sides of that coin.
Yeah.
Lord of the Rings, masterpieces. Also, fantastic character performances. I'm just going to name one scene when Aragorn says goodbye to Boromir.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
It's
yeah.
just, you're touched. Not only is the score incredible, but Viggo Mortensen just killing it.
Oh, yeah. No, amazing. Yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah.
But
yeah,
then
yeah.
you get to the Hobbit trilogy, which one children's book split into three movies, and you're just like,
yeah.
what is this?
Yeah, and it's I think it's a reflection of the times. I think Dune, as good as it is as an entertainment, it's still reflecting where that big scale filmmaking is going, where now talented directors are focused more on what do I want to put on the big screen as opposed to what do I want to say with these large images? Because what, you know, what even made Titanic such a good, you know, to be honest, soapy epic was that, you know, yeah, the ship is massive. The ship looks fantastic and the production design is stunning. But audiences really cared for Jack and Rose. You know, the audience really genuinely wants to see them get together. Billy Zane is a great asshole.
He's so fun. I'll give you another ship movie, which I hope we can talk about in some form on another podcast, Master and Commander. It
is
a Napoleonic war movie epic set on a boat. And you care about the whole crew. And
yeah.
there are a lot of crew. I think it's one of Russell Crowe's best performances.
Oh,
so it can be done. There's so much heart. You just feel it.
Even Gladiator. To be honest, now that you brought up Russell Crowe, Gladiator, I rewatched it recently, right, because of Napoleon.
Gladiator 2 is also coming out this year.
Oh, yeah. Oh, you're right. Oh, my God. I keep forgetting that's a thing. But Gladiator 1, imperfect movie. I actually don't think it's aged that well. But at least there are moments where you genuinely care for Maximus. I'll be honest. I never care for Paul Atreides on the level I care sometimes for Maximus while watching Gladiator. There's never a scene that...
That's
you know,
a hot take, but that's kind of the heart of what we're talking about here.
I mean...
Same
yeah.
with Blade Runner 2049.
Yeah.
I'm like, I get you're the vehicle for the plot, but like, again, I'm not emotionally invested.
Well, I'll make this comparison. Gladiator. Is there ever a moment in Dune Part 1 where you feel for Paul when they kill his dad, the way you feel for Maximus when he finds his dead family in Gladiator. Right? Is there ever a moment
that? I feel for his dad. That scene that I mentioned earlier.
Oh, well, sure. Yeah, yeah. No, well, Oscar Isaac.
But no, really, there was 100%.
Yeah.
Yeah, that sense of betrayal.
Yeah, well, and the heartbreak, right? That sense
of betrayal
of
later, but the initial loss.
Well, yeah, that sense of loss and sorrow that you get from Russell Crowe in Gladiator. Yeah, you don't get it. And I guess maybe it's because Denis is trying to play into this idea of like, well, I mean, he's Jesus. You know, like Paul Atreides is like cosmic Jesus. He doesn't really have to. He has to be this kind of semi-mystic all the time, you know. No, I just think, I just think there's not the same kind of heart and soul in it as
he just doesn't feel like a character director, ultimately.
Yeah, that's the thing.
Maybe he is, but if we're not getting that sense of performance and that emotion, then something was amiss.
It's weird,
a much smaller movie, but Pig, one of the best films of
2022. Oh, well,
but my point is, it's a simple story. It shouldn't work. Everyone knows Nicolas Cage's track record, but my God, just thinking about it makes me just like go into another headspace.
Although that director is also now doing the blockbuster game. They've got Quiet Place, the prequel, coming out.
Day one or something.
Yeah, coming out this summer. So we'll see, right? That'll be an interesting experiment to see if the heart you get in Pig transfers, how the sensibility of that director will now translate to this blockbuster zone of A Quiet Place. But overall, though, I think this is still, it's a very good sequel. It's a really nice,
well, very nice continuation.
A lot of fun.
Literally everything about part two is better than part one.
It's a lot of fun. It's
a genuine blockbuster.
Popcorn experience. Great music. The production design, again.
All those things.
Flawless, you know.
The CGI. Like we said, I think it was literally flawless.
And together with Dune Part 1, looking at it as a whole, you know what? This is probably the best take we'll get on this book. I'm sure they'll remake it 30 years. I'm sure 20 or 30 years from now, somebody will remake it.
HBO will turn it into a
spin-off
series like they're doing with Harry Potter.
Of course, with Dune, the thing is there are a whole... no, it's not a given. Star Wars also has a mass array of extra books, but spin-off books, but Disney, you know, decided they're not canon, so they're not using them. But if they wanted to keep adapting stuff, there's still... So the big question right now for fans is, technically Dune is done. So if there's a third movie, it would most likely be Dune Messiah, which is the book that follows Dune. So that's the big question. Will Dune Messiah now become a movie?
Or multiple movies.
Or multiple movies. I don't know. I confess, I've never read Dune Messiah. And I read Dune in high school, so I'm assuming these movies are very, from what I remember, Denis' take is very accurate. But it's a good one to go watch this weekend. Go spend.
Look, people are going to do anyway, but
go drop those $50 on
Dolby experience, IMAX experience. Look,
iced at
look, guys.
The region,
I understand
region,
yeah. It's fantastic to be excited for film, and I love to see the energy out there, but also not everything is either has to be a masterpiece or the worst thing of the year. You can still really like this film and try and view it from a critical eye. The best way I can think about it, a year from now, if you look back at the things you're saying from your initial reaction, which, by the way, a lot of people out there are saying as fact, will you be embarrassed by, like, what? Why did I get swept up in this? Look, Barbie's going to turn 1 year in July. I bet you we're going to start seeing YouTube 6-hour videos saying, oh, Barbie isn't as good as we remember. It's like, have fun with it, but, you know, ultimately, we want to keep our head on our shoulders and continue to foster critical thinking.
And honestly, go see Rebel. So go find Rebel. It's probably streaming somewhere online right now. In fact, let me quickly check here since we have the technology.
The power of the sun in our hands.
Exactly. Because that, now that's an epic that is genuinely moving.
Well, it was our favorite film of the year. And hopefully before the Oscars, we'll do a special do we recommend where we do alternative Oscars.
So
and
see,
I bet you...
You can watch Rebel now for $3.99 on Amazon Prime versus dropping $16.99 or something for Dune, which we know you're going to do. But what I'm saying is,
it's not the masterpiece that you think it is. Go watch Rebel.
Yeah.
As a counterpoint.
As a counterpoint.
Open your horizons. Expand your frame of reference. Again, we're not saying you're wrong for thinking that, but also, you know, what's the context for why you're saying that? Is it because you only watch the big blockbusters? Do you just love Dune? Do you love Denis? Expand your horizons and drop a comment down below if you think we're full of spice or if we're...
Hey, you want a real hot take? I still prefer Revenge of the Sith to this movie.
No, you do not.
To Dune? Revenge of the Sith?
Really?
Come on. Does anything in this movie compare to the lava planet? No, I'm kidding. But if I had
where
to...
Where is he?
If I had to choose between...
Well, I'd pick Annihilation.
You know, yes. Okay. I would pick Annihilation over Dune any day. I prefer Empire Strikes Back to Dune. I'm sorry.
And we'll drop,
I'm
we'll
a Star
drop
Wars
that
kid
atomic
at heart.
Arsenal on you guys for now. But anyway, this is just our thoughts on the Dune experience. I'm glad I saw it in a theater, but I'm ready for the next big film to come out.
Yeah, so, well, keep tuning in. That's our take on Dune. There's a lot more coming up. How will it compare to Kung Fu Panda 4? I don't know. but it's definitely going to be a big summer coming up. This is just the beginning. We've still got Civil War, Twisters,
Kingdom of the Planet of the Apes, which I'm genuinely super excited for.
This month ends with Godzilla.
Godzilla and Kong.
So there's a lot coming up, which we will definitely keep you updated on. Everything coming up for the rest of this spring. Well, I guess we're at the tail end of winter. So we're at the beginning of spring. So we'll keep you updated on everything coming out. Please remember, to like us, share us, leave your comments. Your love and hate, we do not shy away from any discussion on any of the movies or TV shows that we talk about here on this program.
All our links are down below, as usual. But until next time, guys, peace.
Out.